honor to introduce Professor Kenji Fukaya at Simon Center. The title of his talk is A TF for Two Bumper.
Oh, I see. You're trying to.
Thank you very much for introductions. And this is I'm very honored to talk in this conference to celebrate Pyahisa Kuranishi. And first, I want to say a few words about the memory I have with Professor Kuranishi. It was something like 10 or 15 years ago. And that is the only occasion I talked with him. I met him several times. I heard some of his talks, but directly talk is only one time. And at that time, I met in some banquet or some conference, and I asked him whether I introduced with Kaoru Ono some notions called the Kuranishi structures, but I remember that I didn't ask him the permission to use his name. So I took this opportunity to ask him whether whether it is okay to use his name for this notion. And he was very mildly said that he's very happy about it. And I was very happy about this answer also. So that's a small memory. Now I want to talk something about mathematics. That's called a Tiafoya two functor. Right. And this is a joint work with Ayakawa Daini and Max Lipiansky. So instant Fourier homology, which is invented by Andreas Fourier 40 years ago, and I want to talk with it SO3 versions, which is a bit easier than SU2 version because of the non-existence of singularity. And we consider three manifold Y and SO3 bundle on a closed three manifold, which is non trivial, on some two dimensional sum manifold Y. And let AY be a space of all flat connections. And there is some function called a Chan Simon functional on this space of all flat connections. It is by this formula 1/2 of A wedge DA plus 1/3 of A wedge A wedge A trace and integrations. This is a bit cheating because this is a formula in the case of SU2 bundles, but there are similar formula for SO3. And there is the most, so we consider this Chan Simon as a functional on the space of all gauge equivalence classes of connections. So G of Y is a space of, is a gauge equivalent, gauge group. And this is actually S1 valued functions. And the instant of Fourier homology is the, comes from this most theory of these functionals. And so more kind of precisely, this instant of Fourier homology, IY, H, CF, M1. And CFY is a free abelian group whose generator is identified with the flat connections. And M1A is by definition M1ABB, B is all flat connections. And this coefficient is obtained by counting this object. So we consider this Y cross R, it's a four manifold, and we consider connection A, which satisfies this equation. Curvature plus whole disturbed curvature is zero. This is called ASD equations. And this is non-compact, so here are boundary conditions. When this R factor goes to minus infinity, you require it to be A, and in plus infinity to be B. And then you count such a solution, you get this boundary operator. Okay, so now there is another version of Fourier homology, which is a Lagrangian Fourier homology, and this is developed in 1980s also. In this case, we consider a simplistic manifold, which is X omega, closed simplistic manifold. And so it is omega is a, oh, this is non-degenerate two form. So that D of omega is zero. And Ly is a Lagrangian sum manifold of X. It means that its dimension is half of the dimension of X, and omega vanishes. And the Fourier homology is, roughly speaking, a homology of some chain complex, CF L1, L2, M1. And this as an abelian group, this CF L1, L2 is a free abelian group generated by the point of intersection of L1 and L2. And the boundary operator M1P is again this M1P Q, and Q is another intersection point. And it counts the configuration like this. You consider from this strip, and then you have a U, map of U from this strip to X. And we assume it is holomorphic. And then This line is supposed to go to L1, and this line is supposed to go to L2. And for this minus infinity go to P and plus infinity go to Q, and you count such a promoter map and you get this boundary operator. And roughly speaking, a TFA two functor is so the story of a TFA functor, we first construct two infinity category. This is some version of two category. So two of them are, we call it G and S. So G is for gauge theory, S for symplectic geometry. And for this two categories, there are space of two morphisms. And these two morphisms, so the space of two morphisms for this G gauge theory category is this Fréa chain complex, which calculate Fréa homology of three manifold. And the two morphism space, so in the symplectic side, is the Fréa chain complex, which calculate Lagrangian Fréa theory. And two functor is a two functor between these two categories. And then the one important property of this two functor is that if you construct two morphism spaces, then it gives an isomorphism of cohomology. And the Atiyah-Fréa conjecture is just this isomorphism, and we have somehow enhanced this to the two functor things. So now, Atiyah-Fréa functor. So I want to explain what is this G gauge theory two category. So its object is a closed two manifold, which is oriented. And then because the morphism, so morphism from one closed two manifold to another closed two manifold, it's a three manifold Y with SO3 bundle, E of Y, and assume that the boundary of Y is minus sigma 1 cap sigma 2. And the second Spiefeld-Huygens class of Y, EY, restricted to sigma I, is the fundamental class. So that's a morphism spaces. And then we consider this two morphisms. Suppose this, you have a Y and Y prime. Boundary Y is minus sigma 1 cap sigma 2. Minus Y prime is a minus, again, also minus sigma 1 cap sigma 2. Then we glue these two manifold. You have this closed three manifold. You glue Y and Y prime on the boundary, and you have this bundles on it. Then this Fréa chain complex on this closed three manifold is this space of two morphisms. Yeah, that's good. Yeah.
One, two, whose boundary is sigma 1 and sigma 2. And Y23, whose boundary is sigma 2 and sigma 3, then you can just glue them at sigma 3 by 1, 3. So this is a very kind of famous composition in the topological field theory. So that is a composition of one morphism.
What about on the bundle?
We identify bundles on this. So our condition is that the bundle on the sigma 2 is, you assume that W2 is non zero. So SO3 boundary is unique, actually. So we fix some isomorphism between restriction of the three boundary on the manifold to boundary on the two manifold. We fix isomorphism when you define this one morphism. So we use this isomorphism to glue two boundaries on this sigma two. So you get just boundaries on that by 1, 3.
So you fix the bundle over each sigma with W2.
Yes.
That's fixed once and for all, and then you have part of the data is the isomorphism.
Yes, exactly. That's right. Yes, you're right. Thank you. So this is a composition of one morphisms. And I want to explain what is the composition of two morphisms. So what is the two morphisms? You have this sigma 1 and sigma 2. And you have this y1, y2, y3. So boundary of yi is a union of minus sigma 1 and minus sigma 2. So what is the composition? So you have this Fréa chain complex, which calculates this homology, a Fréa homology of instant homology of y1 cap y2. And you have a Fréa chain complex, which calculates instant homology of y2 cap y3. And you have a chain complex, which calculates instant homology of y1 and y3. So the two morphisms should be the tensor product of this first two go to the tensor of the sum. To define this, we cook up this. I'm sorry, my handwriting is not so beautiful, but you have this four manifold. This four manifold has three boundaries. So you consider this blue part, this is the omega. So this is only three domain on complex plane. So this is a two-dimensional thing, and you take a product of omega with sigma one cap sigma two. So you have a four manifold. This domain cross sigma is a Forman pole, and this Forman pole has three ends, R cross sigma 1 cap sigma 2, R cap sigma 1 cap sigma 2, R cap sigma 1 cap sigma 2. So you glue Y1 cross R, Y2 cross R, Y3 cross R to these three boundary. Then you don't have a boundary, but you have a three ends here, 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 and each three ends corresponds to these two, three closed three manifold you obtain from gluing two of them. So you have a closed four manifold whose boundary have three manifold ends. And then there is something called, a relative Donaldson invariant. That means that you take a flat connection here, so you have three ends, so you take flat connections on each three ends. Then you consider anti-individual connections on a four manifold, which is asymptotic to these three flat connections. And then this Donaldson theory gives some number, transfer layer theory gives some number. That is that number is a kind of matrix element of this homomorphism. And this is a chain homomorphism that's known to Donaldson layer. You get this chain homomorphism. That is two compositions. Composition of two morphisms. And then we can go further. So you think that this composition is associative. And we can use some argument to show that this composition is actually associative. And you can specify the chain homotopy that which gives this associativity with the compositions. Then you can go further and further. You get some family version of the Donaldson, relative Donaldson invariant, which gives this NCD structure. So that is a kind of one more with NVD category. You can cook up from Yates theory. But this is not yet the end of the story, because so you have these composition of one morphism, and I explained what this composition means in a level of objects. But of course, these two are categories. So composition is a kind of functor. So you have to say how these two morphisms are sent by this composition functor. That's another story. I can explain, but I just want to skip it now. Maybe if I have a time, I'll go back. But you can do it. So now I go to this symplectic side of this two category. And this is some variant of the category proposed by Weinstein many, many years ago. So this is S. So this object of category is a compact symplectic manifold, X omega. And the morphism from X to X prime is something called a Lagrangian correspondence. That is a Lagrangian submanifold of product of minus x cross x prime. Minus x means that x is minus of the symplectic structure. For example, the identity morphism is a diagonal. That is a kind of basic understanding of this. So what Weinstein proposed is that if you want to define some category of symplectic manifold, then that there is not so good notion of map between symplectic manifold, kind of different from complex geometry. But what Weinstein says that, okay, let us consider this. When somebody borrowed the product as a morphism, then it seems to give a good category. That's Weinstein's proposal. But we can just enhance it, including two morphisms. What is two morphisms? You have these two Lagrangian correspondence, Lagrangian submanifold of X cross X prime. Then you have this Player chain complex, and that is a two morphism. So this is something like enhancement of this Weinstein's proposal. That is this two category. That is Weinstein two category, something like that. But there is something we need to. So what is the composition of two morphisms? So let's say CF L1. So you have the three Lagrangian submanifold L1, L2, L3 on a minus X cross X prime, minus X cross X prime. And you have this Player chain complex, which is given this intersection points, L2, L3, and L1, L3. And then you have this, you have to define this tensor product, map of tensor product of this guy. And this one is something kind of first, I think I heard it from Donaldson's talk in the University of Warwick. You want to calculate this triangle to get this composition of morphisms. And now I just kind of mentioned that you can generalize it to this entity category. That's something conceptually called fire category. So that is this composition of two morphisms, and you can make it homotopy associative and you get the entity category. So this is a one category. So this is a morphism category, which is an entity category. And then, but this is actually a bit oversimplifications, because the Lagrangian Flare theory is actually rather delicate things to define. And to have this work category, more honestly, we need to include immense Lagrangian some manifold and also something called bounding coefficients. And that one needs to somehow full mechanism I developed with Otaono for this 20 or 25 years. And also we need to include immense Lagrangians. And this generalization is due to Akaho and the choice. So we have this long history of this Lagrangian player theory. And actually we use this full mechanism to define Lagrangian player homology and the changing structure to define this category S. And something more, so next thing is the composition of one more. So you have this Lagrangian correspondence L1, 2, which is minus X, Lagrangian sub-manifold of minus X1 plus X2. And you have this Lagrangian sub-manifold L2, 3, which is the Lagrangian sub-manifold of minus X2 plus X3. So I want to compose this multiple. And what Weinstein proposed for this composition of the Lagrangian correspondence is just taking the final product. You have this L1, 2, and L2, 3, and you take a final product over X2. And if this final product is transversal, this final product is a immense Lagrangian sub-manifold of minus X1 plus X3. This is what Weinstein found. So the notion of the morphism composition is nicely defined in this way. But again, this is a bit, this is what Weinstein proposed probably such like 40 or 50 years ago. But this is a bit, so I need to go further. So in this case, I need to kind of define this composition as a kind of A infinity bifunctor. So you have this X1, X2, you have this S, X, Y, X2, whose object is the Lagrangian correspondence. But this is a category, an A infinity category. So you have a morphism, it's a player morphism. So you have to enhance this, so as well as the object concerns, but one side proposed is the kind of the most important part of this composition functor. But you have to include morphisms, that there are two morphisms. We have this AVD bifunctor that defines a composition AVD bifunctor. And this is another long story. So this kind of AVD bifunctor was studied by Wilhelm and Woodworth, kind of in 2005 or something like that. They continued studying for 10 years. And the two of their students are somehow involved, Moll and Botman. They continuously joining this and they keep working on this. And there is a work also by Jan Kirikidi and Max Piansky on the similar subject. And I think this several years ago, in this archive preprint, I think I can complete these constructions. And we can construct this composition functor as an AVD bifunctor for any compact symmetric manifold X1, X2, X3. And that involves some work. And that's again related to this bounding cochain business and this NPDC, and also this partial fundamental chain branches structures. So this is a long story, but I just skip it. So now we define these two AVD categories. And the statement is rather, so once we can do it, we can just state. So this is a theorem with Al-Kabadani, but we wrote only a small part of it. And with Max Libyansky, it's something like 150 pages, but it's probably one third or one fourth. So we have this two functor between two categories, and we have two functors. So then two functor give the isomorphism on this. So you have two morphism spaces. It's a chain complex defined player homology. And you have two functor means that you have a chain map between them. And this chain map induces an isomorphism of homology. That's this theorem says. So I want to say a bit easy part of this construction of two functors. So first of all, so you want to define these two functors. First of all, what do you do for the object? So let me recall that the object of this gauge theory category is a two-manifold sigma. And the object of this symplectic category is a symplectic manifold. So you have to associate symplectic manifold to a surface, two-manifold. That is a kind of natural process. You have this R of sigma. You have this non-trivial associated bundles. You consider the space of all flat connections, modular gauge transformation group. That is classical, like people by Goldman, those people found that this space of flat connection is a symplectic manifold. So this is a kind of most thing. And it's like here we are already kind of seeing this kind of thing. You have a two manifold, then associated space of flat connection. That's first part of constructions. So the second part of construction about one monophysm is rather also kind of normal and simple. So suppose you have this y, it's a one morphism in a category g. So So that the boundary of Y is a union of minus sigma 1 and sigma 2. Then you want to associate to some R of Y. So something you're supposed to associate is a Lagrangian correspondence. That is this Lagrangian summary bound of this minus R sigma 1 cross R sigma 2. And this direct product is actually a space of flat collections and minus sigma 1 sigma 2. Then we consider the space of all flat collections on this Y. Then typically, or after some perturbations, you get a Lagrangian immense Lagrangian summary bound of this product. So that immense Lagrangian summary bound we associate. So that is what we do with the one more reason. But actually, this is a bit oversimplifications. If all R of Y is embedded, then it is monotone, so you have a good fair theory. It is just immense. You need something to have a good immense fair theory. And this Father Akaho Joyce said that in a case of immense Lagrangian, you need to associate some numbers to each set of intersections. In this case, that is a bounding chain in a sense of a fortune. And we need to do something about the bounding chain to have this one more part. But that's a more non-trivial. We can do it. So this is for the one more reason. So now then I go what this so isomorphism on homomorphic two. So you have a y whose boundary is minus sigma 1 minus sigma 2. And y prime whose boundary is minus sigma 1 and sigma 2. Then what is a two morphism from y to y prime? And the gauge theory category is just this instanton play homology of y union y prime. And in a simplex geometry, we associate r of y and r of y prime. And one more, two morphisms between them give the homology. It is this Lagrangian pair homology, symplectic side. And this two morphism, part of this two functor being the chain map from here to here. And the anti-alpha kind of conjecture means that this chain map is actually isomorphism. So this particular isomorphism is exactly by this anti-alpha conjecture. The case is something like a SU2 case, but the SO3 kind of similar things as the pair conjecture. So, but this isomorphism is proved written in some cases. So, if you assume this R of Y and R of Y prime are both embedded in Lagrangian summary bound, then in this case, we can also say that this is a monotone Lagrangian summary bound. Then, logging all the fine framework in that case. And this particular isomorphism in that case is already written in my paper with Al-Kabadain and Lipiansky in this archive post in a half year, 1 year ago. But there are earlier work by Gustav Graf-Salmon. That is the case y and y prime is just a direct sigma cross 0-1 interval. In this case, we grew it. You need some kind of, you know, more precisely, you need to fix boundary diffeomorphism between boundary y and sigma. So you have some particular choice of diffeomorphism. So if you grew y and y prime in the case of direct product, what you get is a surface bundle of S1. So in this case of surface bound of S1, then this isomorphism is proved by Gustav Graf-Salmon something like 30 years ago. So, but we can just combine them and include them. And so, what is two functor version means that you have this isomorphism. And since this is some kind of two functor, it means that there are a lot of operations among three homologies. Kind of composition of two morphisms gives an operation. And the composition of one morphism gives some bifunctor, it gives a lot of operations and linear maps. And what is two factoriality just means that this anti-player isomorphism is functorial with many operations, like a composition and one composition, two composition, blah, blah, blah. So write down all the commutative diagram is rather cumbersome. But you can simply say, that, okay, it is two morphisms. So that makes things simple. Okay, so that is about the statement. Anybody has some questions about the statement?
I think one of the circuits to be a sphere.
Pardon?
Can you think one of sigma to be a sphere, or it has to be higher?
No, I think it is. There's no flat band on S2. So W2 non-zero is a bit difficult. But I think you can take T2. And T2 case is this R of T2 is just at one point. So T2 with the non-trivial flat SOC bundle is something similar to square. I think this is the story of this not clear homology of Kronheimer Broca is related to that kind of cases.
Okay, so now I want to explain something about the proof. And the strategy of proof is a kind of, we use two kinds of machineries. One is this algebraic size of the machineries, and this algebraic size of machineries is something like that. So first we use some notions called the bimodule over two APT categories. And then we use some representability of APT functor. And the third thing we use is this Yoneda lemma, that's related to representability of the functors. And the last thing is the subset called the derived Morita theory. And derived Morita theory in case of a DG category is built by, I think, Toen. And we can make it APT versions. That's related to how there's the composition of APT functor are related tensor product of APT bimodule. That is this algebraic side of the story. That's something like a standard toolkit of APT category, multi-algebra APT category. And this geometric side, we use moduli space, which is called a mixed moduli space introduced by Lipiansky. I'll go that moduli space later on. But then you have this kind of moduli spaces. There is kind of, again, another standard toolkit to study moduli spaces. First, you need some Fredholm theory. It means that locally, this moduli space has a Clarisch descriptions. You have some Clarisch map, and this moduli space is locally represented. Zero set of the component vector manifold. And we need to study the compactification of the moduli spaces, but it's something like some kind of Uhlenbeck, Gromov, blah, 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 Lebesgue singularity theorem, other things, compactifications. And there is something about the Gruen analysis that is kind of, again, the standard toolkit in the theory. You have a three manifold and four manifold, you glue them. And as a vector geometry, you have a short homework curve and you glue them on the boundary. And after you, we are mixed moduli space, so we need something like a mixed viewing also. So you have this another kind of geometry input. And then we can just kind of plug in this geometry input to this algebraic machinery and get this two functor. So that's a kind of strategy of the proof. But I want to go a bit more detail. So let me start first explain some algebraic side of the story. So suppose we have two APT categories, C and C prime, and what is an APT bimodule? Is it some very natural analog of the bimodule of over V? So you have an object C on the C, script C, and C prime on the script C prime. Then we have some D gives some DC C prime. It is an abelian group. So you have two objects, you have an abelian group. And the simplest case is just this two kind of C and C prime has just one object. In this case, it is just a ring, right? Kind of morphism is a vector space, and the composition of morphism space is the product of ring. So in this case, you have just one vector space. It's just a bimodule. But for each pair of objects, you have this ring, you know, by vector space. And you have a boundary. So, but this is not just a vector space. It's a chain complex. This is a boundary operator, which you I wrote n 0 0. That's a boundary operator. So this is a bimodule, so you have a left multiplication. What is it? Suppose you have C1, C2 is the object of C, and C prime is object of C prime. So we have this n1 0. This is a space of morphisms from C1 to C2 of C. And you have this bimodule give C2 C prime, D of C2 C prime, and you have this tensor product, you have this D C1 C prime. So this is left multiplication. So again, you have just one object. Then this C is just a ring with C. This is a module. So this is left multiplications. And you have similar right multiplication. You have this DC C1 prime and C1 prime C2 prime. And then this product goes to DC C prime. This is right multiplication. So this is the ring structure. And this is not the end of the story. For example, for the bimodule in a ring theory, we assume that the left multiplication and the right multiplication commutes. That's one of the important assumptions for the bimodule. So this means that you have some L10 and L01 have some commute. But actually, this is an infinity word. So it's not commutative, exactly commute, but it commutes up to chain homotopy. And that chain homotopy, which gives this commutativity of left and right multiplication, is N11. And also, you have this L10. Should commute with a product of C, M2. And then this product and the multiplication should commute is a kind of usual action for the left module. And in the case of APTUR, it is not exactly commute, but you have a chain commute. That is this M2 zero.
So you can imagine that you have a full many full of this NKL. There is bar complex tensor to this guy. So you have this kind of sequence of infinitely many operations that satisfy some axioms, which in the chain level gives that this gives a homology group in the left and the right modules, and it is commutative in the high associative. That is this infinitely many module. So now there are three kind of simple and natural property of the infinitely many module. So first of all, suppose you have an NPD functor. I'm sorry, I don't want to define it, but you have, yeah, you might have some functor between two countries. And this, you have an NPD functor, then there is an NPD bimodule. So you have a C NPD functor from C to C prime. Then there's an NPD bimodule. C, C prime, C prime. How is it? So you have the two objects, C of C prime, C, C prime of C prime. Then this associate, this C prime, FC, C prime. So C is the object of C, so you apply the functor, you get some object of C prime. And then you take the bold morphism from FC to C prime on this category C prime. This is by definition of the vector space. And you can use this structure so that this gives the bimodule structure. So this is very kind of natural thing. You have a ring of homomorphism. You have a ring of homomorphism. I'm sorry, ring of homomorphism from A to B. Then B is A, B, bimodule. So that's very fun. So this is a kind of category analogy for this. This is the first thing. And the second thing is there are something kind of inverse directions. Suppose we have this AVD bimodule over CC prime. I want to construct the AVD functor from C to C prime. I cannot do it in general, but here I have something similar. I have AVD functor from C to the category of right C prime modules. I mean, right C prime module is just a case C string. So suppose we have this NPD bimodule, you get a functor from C to right C prime module. It's just from C, so you have an object of C, then we should associate C prime, right C prime module. It means that you have any C prime, you need to associate a vector space. That is this DC prime. So this is you can define operations in very natural, but there is more, just kind of your choice. So you have this NPD functor from C to right C prime module. That is very simple. I mean, maybe this is a bit cumbersome to write down, but basically it is this. But now I want to relate this C prime and this category of right C prime modules. That is called the Yoneda functor. The Yoneda proved this kind of thing in the case of set theory, but we can do it in an NPD model. So you have any antibody with C, then there's an NPD functor from C to the category of right C. That is, if you have any C, yeah, another object C prime, you can just consider space morphisms. This is just you have any in A, and A itself is a bimodule of A. So that's very similar thing. So you have the three kind of elementary tools. So now we consider this this diagram. So you know we have to construct some NPD functor between NPD categories. The way to construct the following thing, you have two NPD categories, but first we construct some NPD bimodule D. Then, as I mentioned, you have an NPD functor from C to the category of right C prime module. Give another functor from C prime to this by Yoneda lemma. So I want to lift this functor to the functor from C to C prime. It's not always possible, but we can do it if this image contains the image of Yoneda functor. Because Yoneda functor is the equivalence, that Yoneda lemma. So it means that this image is a representative. So if I need to see this light C module, but this light C module is representable in the image of the functor. So you can prove that this one is representable, then you can lift this functor to get an NPD functor from C to C prime. So that is the strategy to construct. So the strategy of policy. So I want to construct NPD functor from C to C prime. And first we construct NPD bimodule B over these two NPD categories. Then I prove some representability. So here, given C, that this DCC star is representable. Then we get this NPD functor. So that is a kind of toolkit of homology algebra we can use to construct NPD functors. So now I want to carry out this strategy in the case of Atiyah-Flair functor. So what is Atiyah-Flair functor? Atiyah-Flair one functor. So what is Atiyah-Flair one functor? You have a surface. Then sigma minus sigma 1 to sigma 2. Then the gauge theory, you know, this one NPD category, this sigma. And we have this breadth geometry category that is so this is called S of R sigma. So this gauge theory of simple geometry gives both infinite category. And there are two functors should associate. First of all, that this this infinite functor will do. So what I to do? So the strategy, I mean that I need to construct some bimodule over this gauge of sigma and S of sigma. So what it means? So the object of this gauge of sigma is a three manifold whose boundary is minus sigma 1 and sigma 2. And the object of the specific side is just you have a Lagrange sum manifold of R of sigma. It's Lagrange correspondence. So something I need to prove is that I need to construct that any y and l, then I need to construct this Abelian group at the operator y l. And that is so one can do it in a whole way. And as for Abelian group, there's a kind of obvious choice. So we consider this set of pair AP and we take a free Abelian group. So A is a flat formation of Y, it's three manifold Y, you have a flat formation of A, and P is a point of L. And you restrict the flat formation of A to sigma, you have a flat formation on sigma, and L is a Lagrange sum manifold of R of sigma, so it also a flat formation of R of sigma. So you assume that the restriction of A to sigma is P. So this finite set, I mean, generically, it's a finite set. And so you take Abelian group, which is related by this finite set. But this is a kind of Abelian group. So then we need to define boundary operator. So the boundary operator gives this M00 gives this from this to this. So we need to kind of construct the boundary operator. And it means that you have two objects here, a p and a prime p prime. You need to define a number, which is a coefficient of the boundary operator. And that number is calculated exactly by something called a mixed equations introduced by the PRC. And I want to explain what is the mixed equations in this case. So first of all, we consider this connection A, which is a flat which is a connection on Y cross R. So let me remind you, why is the three manifold with boundary sigma? So Y cross R has a boundary which is sigma cross R. It has a two-end correspond to minus infinity and plus infinity of R. So you have this flat connection A on Y cross R, which satisfies this Einstein-Hodel equation. Then we next consider U is here. U is a map from 0-1 interval cross R to R of sigma. R of sigma is back in manifold. I mean, okay, this is a, in this case, a scalar manifold, not natural complex structures. And I assume that this U is a holomorphic map. Then we have some boundary conditions. We need the Fourier homotopy. So first of all, we restrict U to 1 tau. So 1 tau is this side. And then we assume that it is contained in here. Which is a natural Lagrangian boundary condition of Holmberg tau. And then the next, and then the most important is that what happens on this matching line. So matching line is that you have this sigma cross R, which is a boundary here. And also you have this zero cross R, which is a boundary on the other side. And then we assume that this connection A restricted to the boundary, sigma cross R at any tau is flat. And then I assume that it is equal to the U zero tau. It's a platform. It's an element of R of sigma. I bet that says it's engaged with. So this is a kind of matching condition introduced by APRC. So we have this matching condition on this line. And then you have some asymptotic conditions that plus infinity and minus infinity. And as I said, I have AP and A prime B prime. So A, this connection A is required to asymptotic to flat correlation A as tau goes to minus infinity, and this map U is asymptotic to this point P in L because of this boundary condition. And this matching condition means that the restriction of A to sigma is equal to P. So they have this condition minus infinity and plus infinity. So you have this much mixed equations, and then now we have this nice Fredholm theory. So we can just count the solution of this solution of the mixed equations. How do you get this boundary operator? So that is M1. And this story of the mixed equation has a long history. So first of all, I say that this particular formulation of the mixed equation is introduced by Max Lipiansky in this archive post, something almost eight or nine years ago. But there are similar equations which is studied by myself in a paper on GAFA 1998, and also Salomon and Welker studied very much related to this moduli space. And we use some like that, the Stalin welfare to kind of treat it. But then recently, with Kavadani and Pianski, we wrote down some basic toolkit of the mixed equations. Basic toolkit means that the Fred Holm theory, then we have singularity, compactifications, and the Gluing analysis. So that's written in this paper. So we can have this natural toolkit, so you can just use this. In a similar way as you can play a theory, you can take this from there. Now, I want to explain a bit about the light module structure. So what is the light module structure? You have this mixed equation given this chain complex. And you have this Gedisori category of the molecule spaces. So you have this CFY prime Y and this AFYL should go to AFY prime L. So I need to define it. And that is also kind of defined by some counting something. So we consider this thing here. You have this A, connection A. So you have on the left hand side, in a similar way, when we study this product structure on the Gedisori side, you have some four manifold. Which are the n, which is the boundary sigma cross r, and 3n, 2n is this kind of mixed n, and 1n is just a minus y prime cross 1. You have this part cross sigma, and then you glue this to three manifold boundary here, you get this kind of three manifold. And you take this instantons on this four manifold side, and you take from a curve on this side, and you require again the mixed equation, mixed condition here. Then you get this moduli spaces, and whose basic toolkit is almost the same as this original one. So you can count this order, and that counting gives this left module structure. And then you can go on to calculate right module structure, and all this NKL is constructed in some variant of this construction. So now we have this value, and I need to prove that this bimodule kind of this guy is represented by an object C, and but there is an obvious solution. So what is it? So I want to have this three manifold Y with boundary, and then there's a kind of right module which associates L to this Satya pair Y L, and I want to prove that this right module is representable. And the obvious counting is just this R of Y thing. You have this Lagrangian sum manifold R of Y. And the claim is that this Lagrangian sum manifold represents this functor. And in our superficial way, part it is easy because this guy, as a chain complex, gives is generated by the pair of A and P, and A is a product connection Y, P is an element of P, which is satisfied compatibility. But this player chain complex to calculate this Lagrangian player theory of R of Y and L is exactly the same thing. So in a superficial level of the Savoyan group, which is trivial. And we can use also mixed moduli space to have a chain map which realizes this isomorphism. So this gives the representability. So we construct this at your player function. So now, yeah. So I just go back to this composition functor of one more thing. So let me remind you, I just mentioned that we have these two, so you have these three surface, so I need to construct this composition infinity by functor for this Gedisori side. And the strategy to construct this by functor is very much the same as the case of Akiya-Fréa functor. So what is, so this is a by functor. So you can imagine that to construct functor, you have to construct a tri module. I don't want to define tri module, but it's a kind of left. So left from this left action from these two and right action from that summer. So you want to construct tri-module. So what is tri-module? So tri-module is that you have this yij. So y12 is boundary sigma 1 sigma 2. y23 is boundary sigma 2 and sigma 3. And y13 is boundary sigma 1 sigma 3. Then we have to define chain complex. So that is tri-module. And there is an obvious choice. So we consider this three manifold. So that you have a y12 which bounds sigma 1 sigma 2, and y23 bounds sigma 2 and sigma 3, and y13 bounds sigma 1 and sigma 3. So you can just glue that together. You get closed three manifold, and you take a Fréa's chain complex which is by instanton the homology of this closed three manifold. So that is this tri-module series. And I just want to draw one picture how to define this left action. So left axiom means the following thing, right? You have this one, y1, 2, y2, 3, y1, 3, but you have another y1, 2 prime. So y1, 2 prime is another segmental, which bounds sigma 1 and sigma 2. Then I want to construct this map, CF y1, 2, y1, 2 prime, CF y1, 2 prime, y2, 3, y1, 3, goes to CF y1, 2, y2, 3, y1, 3. So we have this kind of example. I call this Gauge theory problem. So how did it? So this is a formal code which has exactly three boundary. So I draw this sigma one and sigma two, and this is the kind of this is a domain. These are two dimensional things. This green part I multiply sigma two, and another green part I multiply sigma one. Third part I multiply sigma three. And then in between this three green things, you have this several fold parts. And then you put this y12 cross r, y13 cross r, y12 prime cross r, and y12 cross r. You have this four domain. You glue this three manifold cross r. Then you get some four manifold, which has three boundary, which has three infinity. And these three infinity exactly correspond to this three. Three chain complex, which define the square of logic. And then you calculate this instanton on this piece. That's again another kind of Dunson invariant. That gives this left multiplication. Right multiplication, all multiplication, higher multiplication, just doing a similar way. And this one does not require so much, but this is just usual Dunson theory.
Okay. So now I want to go to some most. I have 1 minute, right? Okay, yeah. Anyway, so I want to go to the most complicated part of the story.
About that.
So
far, I think for any sigma one, sigma two, we have this infinity factor from this gauge theory side, the synthetic side, which induces this geometric equivalence. But I need to kind of make it compatible with this composition functors. So suppose you have this sigma one, sigma two, sigma two, sigma three. Then no, this is G sigma one, sigma two, G sigma two, sigma three is just this. Then you have this composition functor in a gauge theory side. And then you have, then this guy corresponds to R sigma one, R sigma two, and R sigma two, R sigma three, and R sigma one, R sigma three. Then you have this symplectic side, this Weinstein category, and you have this composition functor in this Weinstein category. So you have these two horizontal things, that's a composition functor in our category. And then you have this horizontal vertical arrow. So vertical arrow is exactly this Athia player functor. So you have these two composition functors and two Athia player functors. And the fact that this is a kind of two category, two morphisms. Exactly means that this diagram commutes. But this is a homotopical theory. So so they have this, you compose this way and compose this way, then you get something which is a kind of NVD bifunctor. So you have this two NVD bifunctor from this pair to this category. Then the claim is that this two NVD bifunctor is a homotopic to each other. You have to define the notion to FT functor is homotopic. That we can do. That's another toolkit of this FT category. So you have these two compositions, and the claim is that these two compositions are just homotopic. And there's a story that becomes because the composition of two functors and two molecules is a bit kind of cumbersome thing to define, and kind of homotopic equivalent, homotopy between two functors is a bit.
But there are, so the way to do is the following things.
So the strategy is the following thing. So we consider these two compositions. These two, I mean, you have this first thing, you have this two compositions. This composition, so the proof is that two compositions should be compatible. So I just want to compare these two compositions. But factor is a bit harder to study. So remember that the principle I just explained at the beginning is that factor corresponds to binomial. In this case, it's a two bifunctor, so this corresponds to a trimer. So if you consider these two combinations, it gives some trimers, and left from G sigma 1, sigma 2, D sigma 2, G sigma 3, and right from S, R sigma 1, R sigma 3. So you have these two trimers. And this homotopy means that these two trimodules is actually homotopy equivalent. So I need to construct this homotopy equivalence between these two trimodules. And the third is the following. So first we need to calculate these two trimodules. So how to calculate? That is something called the derived Morita theory. I can just write down something. You have this kind of ring homomorphism, A to B. Another ring homomorphism to B to C. F and G. So this gives some B is a B bimodule. Then you have this C is a B C bimodule. Then you take tensor product over B. Then this is a C over A C. So this tensor product corresponds to the composition of the functions. So that is this derived Morita theory. And this is actually so this is all the tensor product in the case of ring theory. But in the case of MPD category, you have to do it over in the derived sense. So you can just calculate this derived tensor, the composition of the functor using derived tensor product. That is we use from this side. But on the other side, actually we use something similar, but in the Hom function. So you have this some Hom function. So you have this derived tensor product and derived Hom function. And then you have to prove some chain map from one side to the other. And you can imagine that this derived tensor product is a kind of tensor product of many things. And then home is a subproduct of many things. And chain map from one to the other is a kind of from many data product to something. So I don't want to write down. I see something like a 10 tensor product factors and two one. So the fact that you need a homotopy equivalence means that you have some particular map which gives some 10 or something to one. So you need to cook up some very complicated map. But then what's funny is that you can just take this something called a mixed drum. And if you calculate this mixed drum, and you think about this mixed drum, you know, this mixed drum has several ends, something like 10 different kinds of ends. And then you cook up the modular space of this mixed drum, and you calculate how this end looks like. So you have to consider the case of the dimension zero, you get number. That gives this homomorphism. Then if you consider the modular space of dimension one, then you analyze what is the boundary of this modular space. So you have this many different kind of boundary component. And then you relate it to algebra. You have this 10 term equation, which is kind of tell what I want to have many terms. Zero. And then if you just think a bit about homological algebra and what this equation means, then this equation just means that this particular map you define is a trimodule. But that's a proof, and this mixed drum is a bit complicated to explain. But so I just to say a few minutes to explain what it is. So you have this drum. So this upper side is something called gauge theory. So I just explain what is the composition function gauge theory. So that is basically this upper side. When the lower side is something like a which I call homotopy drum. It's a map from this S1 cross something. To somebody, yeah? And you have this U1, U2, U3 homework map in a different domain, which goes to R sigma 1, R sigma 2, R sigma 3. And we have this boundary condition here, it's a kind of given the correspondence. And this red line is again matching conditions. You can try to cook up some matching conditions. So then you have this pair. Pair of gauge theory objects and Holmankov object, which kind of have compatibility on this matching line. And then you have this kind of places that there are many. So this part is corresponds to this composition functor. And this part corresponds to this composition functor in symplectic side. And this point corresponds to the pair functor. So you have some many ends, but each end corresponds to one of these factors. Or kind of B of C, F, L, I, J, something. So you can just look up this mixed drum. And the basic story to work out the package is very similar to the simple basis. So you can just analyze this mixed drum. and to get this homotopy equivalent. Now, we have a chain map, and then once you get a chain map, homotopy equivalent is rather trivial because you can just keep your case energy is zero, then everything is identity. So that's a proof that this is. Okay, yeah. So, but as I said, that this is not yet written. So, you can imagine that it's a bit legacy to write strategies. Okay, I stop here. Thank you very much.
More questions?